Because we have some people gone today, I feel like Moses is part of the Red Sea here. It's great to be in the house of the Lord with you today, amen?
Yes, amen.
It's great to be able to worship with you, and I welcome you to Fisher's Point Community Church. We are so grateful that you are here today, coming and worshiping with us. As we get started today, there's a few announcements. First of all, if you look around you, maybe on the pew or something, you might see a connection card. If you can go ahead and fill out that connection card, and you can just drop that connection card in the offering basket later on with your big bag of money that you're just sitting right in there. That'll be exciting. We just wanted to get a good idea for who is here today, maybe a little information about you to follow up. And then on the back, you'll see some blank lines that you can either use that to pass notes like in the middle of class or something, or you can get us some information like a prayer request or something to that effect, and we will go ahead and give updates and reach out to you and all that. So a few announcements as we get started today. First of all, today, I got the wrong week. Okay, here we go.
Don't announce stuff that already happened.
Yeah, like, if you go in your time machine, you'll notice. There will be no children's church today. Anytime we have a fifth Sunday of the month that we have kids in the service, as a family service. So the kids today even got little kits that they can kind of follow along with the message, and they can color, and they can fill in the blanks and all of that, and do some activities, and we're excited about that. I know the kids will be excited about that as well. Also, here's the point. Youth will meet tonight at the home of Brenda, and Miss Brenda might be here in a little bit. Maybe she's preparing for tonight. Who knows, you know? But let Pastor Jess know if you are a teen or you know a teen that needs a ride. So it's out there in Noblesville, and she lives on about 12 acres out there. And we're doing this whole thing that Pastor Jess talked about last week, and that is connecting generations. So we do combine with Fortville Church of the Nazarene for our youth group, but sometimes they do something called connecting generations where they will connect with people in their congregation. And we thought, hey, the weeks that they do that would be really neat for us to do that within our congregation as well. So if you're also interested in hosting, please contact Pastor Jess, and we'd love to get you plugged in for that. On November 8th, there is an outreach opportunity coming right at you here and giving you the opportunity to be a part of this outreach. We are partnering with Kathy Thomas, and she's a lactation consultant, and there's going to be a certain seminar workshop here for ladies that are a part of her network. And we are reaching out to them, making little good bags and setting up a table, but just really wanting to pour into them and to really make them feel loved. And if you're interested in being a part of that, especially for child care, because we need some child care workers to be able to, during that time, to be able to watch the children, please contact Pastor Jess as well. Not finally, but here's something else for you. Teresa Carter is looking for some, her own daughter saying boo, no. There is help that's needed for a fourth grade class at Shepherd Community Center. So we're kind of the room mom for that particular class. So we help them with activities and provide little gifts and things like that. And on Thursday, November 16th, everyone say November 16th.
November 16th.
Yes, that's right. If you said that out loud, that means you're volunteering. So Thursday, November, gotcha, no. November 16th, we are sending some people over there to help with the Thanksgiving party that they're doing. So if you have any questions, and we need some volunteers for that. So contact Teresa. Teresa, can you wave? She's a lovely. So contact Teresa for getting in to be a volunteer for that. You know, we have a ministry here in the church, as you probably already know, called Bridges Ministry. And we have the opportunity that we can pour into people from other countries and other language groups by doing a conversations class and teaching them English. So it's called, on the web, it's called Bridges of FPCC. But there's something I wanted to share with you that has been really cool that's happened recently. And I thought this was so, it's like a circle, a full circle. So, Bridges Ministry, we reach out to and help all these different language groups. There's one of the ladies that's a Spanish speaker, and she has actually invited us to do a conversations class, a Spanish conversations class. So she's been so blessed by what we've been doing. She says, hey, how many of you would like to learn Spanish? So every Saturday at 9 a.m., beginning on November 11th, we're invited to a virtual Spanish conversations class. Isn't that cool? Mm-hmm. So they're inviting us to that. They want to bless us as well. And all of those folks know so many languages, and they're just so brilliant that I'm excited to be a part of this personally. I know a lot of us want to be a part of it. So if you have any questions about that, or you would like to be a part of that, contact Mandy Tripp. That she would love to be... to connect you with that.
I'll send out the link.
Yeah, we're going to send out the link so that you have that, so that you can join in. So, would you all stand with me today to continue worship? All right. Father, thank you so much for today. We thank you that you're a God who loves us so much that you came down and you died, you gave yourself away, so that we can have eternal life. An eternal life that we didn't deserve, but you gave it to us anyway. God, we ask that as we worship you today, that you just hear our voices lift up to you, and you honor that. Pour your Holy Spirit out upon this place. In your name we pray. Amen. Let's sing together.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. A loving hand and an outstretched arm, his love.
11:9. With the kind of wisdom that comes from experience, the Lord gives wisdom to anyone who has understanding.
Raise your hand if you ever need a little wisdom. Unfortunately, God is faithful. We're going to sing another song about that. You might be familiar with it. It's called Courageous Thy Faithfulness. You ever heard it before? Kind of
thought. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father.
Faithful to you this week.
In every way.
Amen. to sing a little different arrangement of Amazing Grace. You're probably familiar with it by now. Sing with us.
Amazing Grace, how sweet a sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious gift that grace appeared, the hour I thirsted.
Would you stand as we continue to sing?
My chains are
Jesus paid it all.
Of that punishment. And today, Lord, we are just so grateful. Amen. You paid it all.
Amen.
And Lord, with our works and with our abilities, with our talents and the things that we can show off to other people, there is no amount of things that we can put on the table that will compare to the life you gave. Father, we love you today. We just thank you so much for going to the cross. But you didn't stay dead.
Amen.
Because you broke the power of sin and darkness.
Amen.
You conquered death with death and brought about life. And Lord, we just ask that as we go around and we see the leaves dying, thou help us to remember that life comes from death, from you. Lord, today we ask that you be with our service as we continue, as we take communion together. And help us to know you are here. In your name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. At this time, ushers are ready. They're going to pass out the elements to you. So Sean's going to play a little bit here. And they're going to pass those out to you. And I'll meet you back for taking.
Say that one more time. I hear the Savior say, thy strength is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus, say it.
Passed out among them. He said to his disciples these words, "This is my body broken for you, for the forgiveness of sin. Take and eat, and when you do, do so in remembrance of me." So they together took and ate. Then he took the cup. He He raised it to heaven and he blessed it and he passed it out so that they could all drink. And he said, this is my blood shed for you. May it preserve you blameless into everlasting life. Take and drink, and when you do, do so in remembrance of me. Thank you, Father, for giving your life. Help us to be servants to you on a daily basis. Help us to live our lives in gratitude of that which you did for us. Thank you for stepping in the way of our punishment. We love you. In your name we pray. So we are going through this series today, or this month. And before we even get into that, I want us to think about, he's going to be singing a song here in just a moment. And I ask that the ushers get ready to collect offerings. But I want to, as they're collecting those things, one of the things that I would like to say is that as Sean sings here in just a moment, I ask that you really consider what your passion is in life. What do you live for? And as he sings, I ask that the ushers prepare for to collect offerings. Sorry if you were going to do that, Sean. I just kind of jumped in here. So, so as ushers are ready to collect offering, tithes and offering, Carl, would you pray for us as we collect?
Father, thank you for the opportunity to gather and worship you and to celebrate the gift, the greatest gift that you've given us in your life. We ask, Lord, that you'll take the gifts that we have to give, that a return of part of what you provided for us, and we know that, but we're obedient to return for the work that you have to be done with us. Bless these gifts and givers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Pure and holy passion. Give me one magnificent obsession. Give me one glorious ambition for my life. To know and follow hard after you. Give me one pure and holy passion. Give me one magnificent obsession. Give me one glorious ambition for my life. To know and follow hard after you.
If you know it, please sing with me.
Know and follow hard after you. To grow as your disciple in the truth. This world is empty, pale, and poor compared to knowing you, my Lord. Lead me on and I will run after you. Lead me on. Your disciple in the truth.
Thank you so much, Sean. Well, I've heard that song so many times, and it just gives me chills just hearing it every time. You know? And like the thought process I was going with a minute ago, this series that we are going through in the book of Colossians, so if you have your Bibles with you or you have your electronic version of the Bible there, we're in Colossians chapter 4, just to get you ready for that. But the whole purpose of looking at Colossians is to look at the circumstances by which the people, the worshipers there in Colossae were going through, the things that led Paul the Apostle to write these particular words, and what that means for us today. And when I'm so glad that he sang that song today, because one of the things that we're going to talk about is what does that passion look like when it's practically applied? If Christ has called us his children, and if we follow God and we call him our Lord, then what does that passion in our life look like on a daily basis when you're at work, when you're at school, when you're at home with your own family? Because our family sees who we really are, right? One of the things that I want to point out before we even get into this passage is something, if I were to just read it, there's an elephant in the room. You know that phrase, the elephant in the room? It's a great idiom because it's when you're with someone or you're with a group of people, then there's something between you that you haven't talked about, you're both thinking about it, but you just won't say it out loud. And I want to make sure that we cover this. It's not necessarily what the whole thing is about today, but I do want to cover it.
Amen.
It's going to talk a little bit about, and the first verse of this particular passage talks about masters and their slaves, is what it says actually in the scripture. Now, when we look at slavery today, we have certain thoughts. And I'm not here at all to say, hey, don't worry about that, because that's not right at all. But one of the things I do want to mention is that this passage of scripture uses a word, and the word is doulos. And the actual translation is bond servanthood. So let me give you an example. So if someone owes, back in these days, we're taking our time machine back, if someone would owe someone a significant amount of money or property or whatever it is that was loaned to them, and they could not pay it because they had not been able to get a job or something of that nature, one thing that would happen would be that person who loaned would actually employ that person. They wouldn't get paid, but essentially they would work off the debt for at least 7 years, for about 7 years. Because what happened was that after 7 years, they were supposed to be set free and they were released of their burden, that they felt like that 7 years for a big debt was something that would equate to whatever kind of debt they would have. If 7 years wouldn't cut it, then usually the transaction wouldn't occur. So there were things that were happening back then and that had to be addressed. Like, this person is your employer, they're not getting paid, let's say an internship or something. No, they're not getting paid, but they're working off their debt. But sometimes the person who would be the employer or the master in this case would get really mean with these folks. And he would beat them, or he would consider them his property. When Scripture, I just want to put this out there, elephant in the room, Scripture is 100% against that. Do we understand that? So I don't want you to get, like, you know, overly enthusiastic whenever I say the word slaves, because probably slaves is not the right way to put it here, but then in a translation version, it would be bond servanthood. And the Bible is against what we view as slavery in today's vernacular. But people could really be blessed by being able to afford something, or house, or get a property and say, well, I got to work for this family for 7 years in order to make it happen. Or it could really get them out of a jam, say, hey, I've lost my job, I've lost everything, and I know I still owe you something. And say, hey, you know, you could come in here and I'll feed you and I'll clothe you and I'll give you a bed to sleep in,
And all you had to do is work for me for those 7 years. So that is the ideal scenario, but we also know that human nature is what it is. So God is saying something through this passage of Scripture, and he does mention this kind of mentality when looking at our faith and the way that we expound upon and show our passion in him. So we're in Colossians chapter 4, and we're going to start with verse 1. So this is Paul writing from prison, so he's in chains, and he is writing a letter to the believers in Colossae. And also, the Laodiceans got to see this as well, so there are some things tucked in there for them as well. So, chapter 4 in Colossians, we're going to start with verse 1. Masters, provide your slaves with what is right and fair, because you know that you also have a master in heaven. Devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful, and pray for us too, that God may open a door for our message, so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ, for which I am in chains. Pray that I may proclaim it clearly, as I should. Be wise in the way you act toward outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. That is a word for us today. That's not just a word for someone 2,000 years ago, but this is an actual word for us today. Amen?
Amen.
So we first need to acknowledge that. And I wanted to get all of your agreement on that, because what I'm about to talk about, I'm going to come back and say, you said you agree with this. It's going to be tough, isn't it?
Yeah.
No, it's nothing like that. But here's the thing. Whenever we follow Jesus, whenever we're doing what he calls us to do, when we're living in this perpetual life of obedience, there are things that sometimes come into our lives and come into our paths and intersect with our daily routine that sometimes we have to deal with because we are not living according to the way Jesus has told us to live. But here's what happens sometimes, is that we are not living the way that Jesus wants us to live. We intersect with one of these instances in which God calls us to the carpet. But then we get going to the Bible and say, how can I look at things to justify the way I live already? Or the way I handled that? Well, God understands. Because he knows that I was upset. God understands because he knows that I went through X, Y, Z. Now, he does understand. Don't get me wrong. But there are some times where we have to look into Scripture and allow it to expose us and examine us. And it's not Scripture that changes. We have to adapt. One of the things that we do as Christians that I'm really mournful of is that we, instead of allowing God to change us, we try to fit Jesus into something we've already decided. So this word that we start with here, after we talk about the masters and slaves, we move on to the second verse, and there is this word that we start with, and it's the word devote. Have you ever been devoted to something? I mean, you know, you're all going to raise your hand. Oh, Jesus, of course. Yes. Jesus. I'm devoted to Jesus. But let's look at it just out of the spiritual realm for just a moment. What does devotion actually look like? If I'm devoted to my schoolwork, it's like I really want to get straight A's and all of this. I'm going to do everything that I can to be able to devote myself. I'm going to put myself in a risky situation, whatever level of risk that we have, so that I can show my worth in this particular thing. I'm devoted to this thing, so I'm making sure that I am giving it my all. Right? We can talk about our work, our 9-to-5 job. We can talk about our schoolwork. We can talk about our parenting. And we know what it feels like to give full devotion to something. Perhaps we call it an obsession. One magnificent obsession, perhaps.
Maybe there's a series of books that you're really into, and you're devoting your time and your energy to just finishing those books, whether it's for leisure or for business. There is a promotion opportunity at work, and you're in your current job, and you're thinking, man, it'd be really great if I could do this. And you know that you need to do certain things in order to be able to meet those qualifications. Perhaps you need to go get a seminar, or maybe you need to work a little bit harder, maybe 45 hours instead of 40, those kind of things. Or in Jess's case, maybe 120 hours a week, and, you know, in a previous job. But you know what it takes to be devoted enough that you can step into that next level. Right? You have a business idea, and you're starting a brand new business. You know what it takes to be devoted to be able to do that thing. So we know what the word devotion means. And sometimes when we use the word devotion, I'm doing my devotions this week or today. We all know that we all get up at 4:30 a.m. and we all do our devotions. Of course, that's what we do, right? Carl says, nope. But when we think of devotion, we think of that. We think of reading, praying, getting up early, having the coffee in hand, and making sure that you take a picture of it for Instagram, of course, so that everyone knows you're doing your devotions. That's what we often think of when we think of devotion. But what devotion actually is this laser-focused motion towards something. Devotion. We're devoted to our family. You know, we can't take a break from being a family. So we're all in. That phrase, all in, is something that we often use. You know, I'm all in for this. Devotion. So I've broken that down. Devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful, and when we break this down, being alert. And specifically, when this particular word was used, alert or being watchful or whatever, it was actually referring to the day that Christ comes back. So be watchful. Look for signs. Look for ways, not just signs of, you know those people, right? That every time something happens, it's like Jesus come back tomorrow. And there's nothing evil about that, but what I'm saying is that it's not just talking about, like, okay, go get in your bunker and get ready. It's talking about how do you treat others with that in mind? Or how do you treat your life? Or how do you live your life with that as the goal and the anticipation? Be watchful. If I'm watchful of something, then I'm always looking around, seeing how I can tweak and make sure that I fit in line with whatever I am anticipating. Be watchful. So in prayer, you know, prayer, we talked about prayer. Be watchful. And then it says, make sure that you complain all the time. No, it doesn't say that. It says, and thankfulness, or be thankful.
Yes.
What would our lives look like in Christ if our lives were partly defined by gratitude? That everything that we do, everything that we move towards in devotion is a reflection of what Jesus did on the cross for us. And the power that he gives us through the Holy Spirit. So, watchful and thankful. So then he turns the tables and says, I'm praying for you in this, and I'm asking you to devote yourself, but I want you to pray for us too. You ever get a missionary letter? You just say, hey, we're doing this particular work, and it's awesome, and you're excited, and you're fist pumping because, like, oh, they're about to build another school. This is great. And it's over there, and you want to see videos because you just want to see what it looks like. Well, Paul didn't have a video camera. And another thing is, he was in prison. So when Paul is not asking, hey, help me get out of here, but he's asking, hey, pray for us that our ministry is fruitful, that's Jesus stuff right there.
Yes.
Don't feel sorry for me in here in prison, says Paul. I want you to pray that everything that I'm doing is according to God's will and that He shows others Himself through me.
Amen.
Okay, so we're moving on here in the passage, and there was something that the first time I read it, I thought, what in the world does that mean? And so we're going to skip down to verse 6. Let your conversation be always full of grace. I think we know what that means. Seasoned with salt. Does anybody use salt? It's interesting, though, whenever you look at, I know how it applies to food. Like when you sprinkle salt on something, generally it tastes better. Unless it's like ice cream or something. But salt is meant to make things taste better. But when you actually look at it chemically, and I'm not a scientist at all, what actually salt is doing is actually bringing out the moisture and the flavor from that thing. So it's bringing out, you're getting ahead of me here, it's bringing out what is already inside of it. So, if Paul is telling us that he wants all of our conversations to be full of grace and seasoned with salt, he's not literally saying, I want you to like sprinkle over whoever's head you're talking to. What he's saying is, I want your conversations to be a reflection of what or who is in you. This is the part at the very beginning where I said, you know, you agreed. You agreed that this is the Word of God, and you agreed. How many of us can raise your hand and say, well, I've gotten there. 100% of my conversations are seasoned with salt and full of purpose. I don't know why you're laughing at that. What does that mean? Right before this, he talks about, you know, approaching outsiders with wisdom. In fact, let me go ahead and read that. I am skipping around a little bit. Let's go back to verse 5 here for a second. I can find it. Okay. Be wise in the way you act toward outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. Outsiders in these days were not people who just didn't show up to church on Sunday. Or that they were not involved in their particular church expression or community expression. These were people who did not know Jesus and perhaps even rejected Him. So what is he saying in that? It's like there are two ways that we can approach those folks. We can come to them and say, and wag our finger and say, you better get right. God, I'm going to stand out of the way because that lightning bolt's coming any moment. Or we can take Paul's advice and be wise in the way that we act towards outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. And then, we skipped around a minute ago, we go into verse 6 and it talks about, let your conversations be always full of grace and seasoned with salt. That's the connection. How are we to approach people who don't know Christ? Full of grace and seasoned with salt. What would that look like if our conversations with people, like, oops, they're frustrating. If we are full of the Holy Spirit and just want people to know what He looks like, what He sounds like, what He acts like. What would our conversations be? What would our interactions be? What would our lives be like if we were always pointed in that direction where we just wanted to know and follow hard after Him? That our devotion to Jesus, because it's laser focused, and if we're thinking about this in terms of if we're going towards Jesus in a jet ski, everything is coming up in its wake because that is our laser focus. That if we are really following after Jesus, there are things that are pulled in, and sanctified, and redeemed because of that. Let
Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. This is not saying you have all the answers. But it does say you have the answer. If Christ is the answer for what ails this world today, how are we showing the antidote? If Christ is the answer for the things that we're seeing around this world, we sing the song, Jesus is the answer for the world today. What does that look like if we say that with our mouth, but our actions, we step out of that? Now, I'm not here to promote legalism. That's not what I'm talking about. But I am talking about promoting awareness and alertness and watchfulness and gratitude. There are even some times where someone can be brought closer to Jesus by the way that we repair the relationship that we have with God. We're not saying, hey, watch me as I sin, and this is going to be great, then I'm going to come back. No. What it is that sometimes you come to Jesus broken, and other people see that, and they're filled with faith because they've seen what it looks like to be transformed. Mm-hmm. Yeah. A repaired relationship can be inspiring as well. What does your devotional life look like? Is it out of, oh, I need to get these steps done because I need to mark it off my list? Is it just a list of things that you do? Or is it a drive and a passion and an obsession that you have that you just can't do anything but? So I do want to point out one more time, at the very beginning, we talk about this idea of bond servanthood. It's this idea that you're working and going forward with someone that you owe something to. Even though within our lives, our resources, our abilities, they will never match up to what Christ did for us, but the question is, do we consider ourselves bond servants for Christ? That he has offered us and given us so much that our life is lived in indebtedness and gratitude. He has given us everything. And if we are living that way, are we talking that way? Are we communicating that way? Are we forgiving that way? It's something to consider, and it's something to be challenged by. Jonathan, come back forward here. I was going to say call a praise team, but I guess I'm a part of it, but I'll have Sean just sing it for you today. But the altars are open here. The altar, we can take this front part of the stage here to, if you want to kneel, come do business with God. And just for a time of reflection, I'm going to just have Sean singing to you today. But we're going to be singing that song again, Jesus Paid It All. Do you believe that today, that Jesus paid it all? Is there anything that we owe him? All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white. You can come up here today and give gratitude. You can come up here today and do some real business with God. The altars are open.
Would you stand with me as I sing?
I hear the Savior say, my strength in thee is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in thee thy all in all. Oh.
Have a great day in the Lord.
Amen.
You're dismissed.